We've just recently passed through the Easter season where we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. One of the things that just occurred to me today was that we shouldn't think of Easter as being the time of year where we celebrate the resurrection. We should look at it the way the early church did. They celebrated the resurrection every single day of their life because they recognized the reality of death and sickness and all the consequences that come with that. They were subject to a rate of dying much higher than us. When you think about half of the babies that were born didn't survive till they were 5 years of age. Funerals were more common than weddings, and they became a focal point of community many times, far to the, well, even though nobody was very happy about it, yet they realized that from dust we've come, into dust we're going to return. And it reminded me of something that I had read about Dave from Richard Dawkins, the famed atheist. He wrote the book The God Delusion that was a million copy seller, which was just frighteningly staggering. But he it's interesting because here is what he said in the book as he summarized what life is really about. He says, there is at the bottom no design, no purpose, no evil, no good, nothing but blind, pitiless indifference. He goes on, he says, some people are going to get hurt, others are going to get lucky, and you can't find any rhyme or reason to it. And then he goes on saying, therefore, if we have any kind of moral outrage, well, that's an absurdity. It's absurd to be outraged about what's going on in life, even a moral injustice. He said, the so-called problem of evil, moral or natural, dissolves into pitiless indifference of uncaring matter. Now, the reality is that anybody who has that view of the world usually is a very depressed and angry person. And if you've ever seen an interview of Richard Dawkins, you realize that he's a very depressed and angry person, just like Sam Harris or as Christopher Kitchens was and others who are so famed for their stance against what they call the new atheism, because they have no hope. They have nothing to really celebrate. And yet when you look at the world that we live in, I mean, how do you find joy in losing a loved one or losing a job or going through some kind of terrible disability in your life, the death of a child or the finding of your family members have passed on? I love something that Chuck Swindoll said in regards to that. He says, what is the final answer to pain, mourning, senility, insanity, terminal disease, sudden calamities, and fatal accidents? The answer to each of those questions is the same, the hope of the bodily resurrection. The hope of the bodily resurrection. We can see the emotions played out in the resurrection story because we find here are the disciples who, it says they all left him, they deserted him. They're in hiding for fear of their life. They've got the shutters closed and the doors locked and, you know, they're terrified that they're going to be the next ones the Romans come to arrest and crucify just as they did with Jesus. When the angels appear to the women and the women come and tell them, they say they did not believe them and they discounted it because to hope at a point of total despair is as frightening as the despair itself is. In other words, when you're super down and then somebody tries to encourage you, sometimes you're afraid to be encouraged because you're fearful that if I give into that encouragement, I'll be defeated once again. Something else will come. And, you know, it's like the old adage, when they said it couldn't get worse, they were wrong. It got worse. And that's kind of a point of view that many people begin to develop towards life. But what we find is that what Dawkins is presenting is kind of like what the Nazis presented to the world and to the German people during prior to World War II and during World War II. Basically, they were promoting the idea that they had the final solution. They were going to create this utopia in the planet. And it's so fascinating because the real final solution is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It takes us from death to life. It takes us from a decaying, decomposing, dust-based entity into people who will inherit divinity. So it's this hope that one day we will take on the full divine nature of God, not only in soul and spirit, but we will embody, become as he is, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 13. He says, we will become as he is, for we will see him as he is. I mean, we will take on that same divinity. We will have that same sonhood that he has with the Father, a sonship that he has with the Father. And that's the final solution to mankind's challenges and difficulties. Look at the opposite. Hitler promised the final solution, as not as Marx did, as Engels did, as Lenin did, as Stalin did, all these dictators have done throughout history. They promise, follow me, support me, and we'll walk into this socialist utopian where everything is wonderful and all problems disappear. And yet, what was the end result of the final solution? Well, not only did it destroy 90% of the Jews who lived in Poland, two-thirds of the Jewish population in the world was wiped out and destroyed. And so you look at it, we talk about oftentimes that Hitler is responsible for the death of 6 million Jews. In reality, he was responsible for the death of at least 12 million people, because as many Jews as he killed, so too were the German people killed as well. I mean, we know that the Germans lost about 5 million young men in war. They're soldiers who were killed. And it's estimated that there's at least another 2 million who died in Germany as casualties of the war because of the firebombings and even the 300,000 or 400,000 people that Hitler executed amongst his own citizens, not even including those who were disabled or mentally disabled who he executed as well. And there's kind of a stark irony, as many as those who Hitler killed amongst the Jews were also the same number or more that died amongst the Germans. You know, at the end of the day, we find that there's a justice of God that shows itself, but oftentimes it's in the aftermath of horrible things. One of the things we look at today and say, the reality is most of the Jews in the world would not live in Israel today if it hadn't been for the Holocaust. That's why Israel became a nation, was because these survivors of the Holocaust made their way to a place because they concluded there's only one way we can be safe, and that's if we have our own national identity and we have our own army and our own economy. That's the only way and only place where a Jew will be safe in the world. So it's interesting because that was their logic and their reasoning, but many of us believe that was God's way of getting them to return to the land so that it might begin to put into play the events that eventually would lead to the end times. So is God there and does he care? Is he silent? No, he's there, he cares, he's listening, and he's speaking to us. He speaks through his word, he speaks through nature, but he also speaks to you and I through the various circumstances that we're going through every day. And let's be listening. Let's be listening for the voice of God today that we might hear what he has to say in this time. God bless you and hope that gives you a helpful thought. In Jesus' name, amen.